Can you all hear me without a mic?
Yes.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Anthony, for inviting me here and giving me the chance to revive this sort of smouldering love of mine. And thank you, Ted, and technology for giving me a marvelous excuse for stumbling halfway through my talk. From the talks this morning, I've found an extraordinary number of themes that link into what I was going to talk about. We heard about the start of life on the planet. I'm going to talk to you about the start of culture and civilization. And like we heard about Alan Watts, my job this afternoon is to try to get you excited and boost your energy levels by inviting you to return and read the world's longest running bestseller, Homer. I don't know how many of you know who or what Homer is. I'm not talking about Homer Simpson. May I just for 5 minutes remind you what Homer is. Homer is the name given to the author or authors of two books of verse. One is called the Iliad and the other is called the Odyssey. They were written, and they were some of the first things ever written in the Greek alphabet in about 730 BC. So nearly 3,000 years ago, and they describe events, or they're based on events that may have happened 500 years before that. And they're the story of a war called the Trojan War and its aftermath. The Trojan War itself is described as having lasted for 10 years, and the aftermath is described lasted another 10 years. And yet these two books tell the whole story of both these events, one just 4 days of the war, and another just 2 weeks of the 10 years of the wanderings. To give you an idea of them, both books are about 12 or 15,000 lines long. They're half of each book is action and half is direct dialogue. And although the details of the history of them is uncertain, it is generally believed that they were composed by one person who put together a whole series of other spoken verse dramas, or just verse narratives, that all coalesced into one shape, and even now achieve an extraordinary coherence. They were probably put together first in about 800 BC, as I say, written down in 700, then codified gradually over the next few hundred years. At the great times of the Greek civilization in Athens, there were competitions to recite them, and they survived through the depredations of, first of all, the invasions from the tribes that created the Dark Ages after the collapse of the Roman Empire, and then the invasions of the Muslim armies, because there were texts that survived in Constantinople. And Homer was amongst the first books ever printed in the original Greek. And they've been on bestseller lists ever since. There was an edition of the Odyssey produced by Penguin just after the Second World War, written by a man called E.V. Rue, which is still the best-selling ever Penguin. The questions I'm going to ask, and ask you to join in me in looking at, are two. First, how can such work, based on something that probably never happened 2,500 years ago, still be so popular? What is the chord that it strikes in all of us? And then going deeper than that, perhaps, why does it matter? I have personal reasons for it being popular with me. I was brought up on the stories, as were many people, in English people of my background. They were my bedtime stories, the stories of the wanderer Ulysses, of the wicked witch and the vicious giant he had to blind, of the nobility of Achilles and Hector fighting for their lives outside the walls of Troy. And then later, at school, we read these books in a classroom that was more than 500 years old, where I knew that these books had been read for 500 years. And on summer days like this, in the mornings, we would read these books sitting by the Thames on a beautiful lawn. And then 20 years later, I was sailing in the Aegean, and of course I took Homer with me, and I found myself amazingly reading in Homer a description of Odysseus passing through the very waters that I was sailing 2,500 years before. Those are the reasons it speaks to me. But there are much bigger and more general reasons that it's popular. It's between them, they cover every possible range of human emotion. There's extreme pathological violence and great tenderness. There's extremely fast action and very gentle thoughts. There's revenge. There's forgiveness. There's love, gentle, tender love. There's sex. There's hatred. There's friendship. Everything is there. Every range of human emotion is there. So that is something that seems to appeal to everybody. There's great subtlety of some sorts in the speeches and in the actions. Other times, frightening directness. And all this, remember, characters who are mythical, but yet come to life. And perhaps one part of the genius of Homer is that he makes the individual and the episodic into something eternal that we can all relate to. He brings legends to life. It's part of our cultural DNA, whether we know it or not. So many of the stories that are told in Homer are part of the fabric of Western culture. Now, there's another way that Homer matters, which is that it's to literature. There are two ways, really. One is to literature, and one is to human Western thought. In terms of literature, he really is the foundation. In Homer, written, as I say, 2,500 years ago, you find almost all the devices and stories that have come up in almost all Western literature ever since. First of all, the stories. The story of a seductive goddess, of a wicked giant, of a witch, of destructive sirens, of the bravery of a hero, of the courage of a man being washed away at sea and scrambling ashore, of falling in love with a beautiful princess. These are absolutely standard themes that you hear, of course, with topical, contemporary variations, but they all start with Homer. There's a direct line in literature from Homer through to the great stories of the romances of the Middle Ages by a Virgil, perhaps the diversion by a Virgil, through to Milton, through to the World War I poets, World War II poets, to Narnia, to Tolkien. It's all just a rehash of it. Let me give you some idea of the literary devices that he uses that are so astoundingly modern, almost cinematic. There are flashbacks. There are incredibly fast changes of focus from one scene to the next. There's onomatopoeia, using the verse to make the sound, and I'll give you some examples of that later. There's a very sophisticated plot. It's running through each of these books is the huge themes of dishonor, revenge, retribution. And inside that huge theme are all the details of men being killed, men being loved, women seducing men, but never losing that thread of the overarching theme. And there's great suspense. You know something's going to happen, but it takes you a long time to get there, and it's all the more dramatic when it does. All these are themes that every novelist tries to create. And whether he knows it or not, it's all there in Homer. The characters are incredibly vivid and well drawn. And you may be amazed to know that some of the leading characters are women. We think of the Iliad as being about Achilles, and the Odyssey obviously being about Odysseus. But the female characters are just as powerful as Helen, who started it all. Hector's wife Andromache. There's the nymph Calypso. There's Penelope. All of them incredibly vivid and rounded characters. And of course, one of the great tests of a novelist is that he can bring the minor characters to life. Homer even manages to bring Odysseus' dog to life. In fact, he brings him to death. It's one of the most pathetic scenes in the whole book. But after all his wanderings, Ulysses has come home in disguise. But the dog recognizes him, wags his tail, and dies. It's the first morality tale, just like any other TV soap. But you're dealing with a very, very high issues and levels of morality. And this brings me on to why Homer really matters. We heard this morning answer to the question of where do we come from? And I argue that a lot of our literary life and culture comes from Homer. But what is the question that Homer asks? He asks, why are we here? How do we cope? What is man's place in the universe? Now, this may seem to you a very extravagant claim for two verse poems written about a mythical event 2,500 years ago. But I'd like to take you through my argument, and I hope it will encourage you to try to read. You see, of course you can say at a superficial level that the Iliad is a story about Achilles and the wrath of Achilles and how that caused all sorts of trouble. And you can say that the Odyssey is just the story of Ulysses wandering home and having all sorts of adventures on the way. But it's much more than that. At one level, one going down deeper one level, the themes of the Iliad are war and death and honor and reward. And the themes of the Odyssey are peace and life. They're both about how man relates to other man, how man relates to nature, and even more important, how man relates to gods. Questions, what is success? How do we cope when the gods seem to be against us? Now, as you go forward to the 17th century AD, Descartes said, man is because he thinks. Cogito ergo sum. Homer, 1500 years before that, said, man chooses. And that's what's making man. Because in Homer, the great heroes and almost everybody in the book are choosing, not between action and inaction, or between good and evil. They're having to choose all those. The two superheroes of both books, on whom all the action turns, have to make the most terrifying choice a man can make, which is between remaining human or becoming an immortal. Very specifically, both these heroes are offered the choices. In Odysseus' case, by the nymph Calypso he's been living with, who is a goddess. She says, stay with me and I'll make you immortal. Achilles is offered the choice of not fighting Hector, whom he must defeat to avenge the death of his great friend Patroclus. But he knows, it's written, that if he kills Hector as he must, he himself must die. But yet they both make the choices to remain human. And the story of about this, that it's humans who have choices, this is what makes a man, and that we take those choices. Homer was criticized by Plato because he made the men more noble than gods. And isn't that a magnificent thing to hear? That we humans are more noble than gods. And if you read Homer, you will find out that it will have this amazing effect on you, that it raises the dignity of man. And that's why it matters, and that's why it's the Homer who shows that things have causes and effects, and that man chooses and makes things happen. That, I think, is one of the fundamental reasons why Western civilization is what it is. And it all starts with these two books written 2,500 years ago. And if you think they're not modern, in the light of what I've been saying, what do you think of the plots of Harry Potter? Here is a boy who is offered the choice almost of being immortal, but he chooses to remain mortal and deal with his demons, as they're called, with the gods, with the wicked magicians. And in Britain, more somberly, I don't know if any of you have heard of a little village called Wootton Bassett. It's a village of no importance. But it happens that that is where the coffins of British troops who were killed in Afghanistan are brought on their way for a proper burial. And the streets there are now lined with people who are offering their silent homage to their heroes. And that is exactly what happens in Homer. The Iliad ends, the last words of the Iliad are, and so were completed the funeral games of Hector, the horse king. Nothing could be more modern, or more relevant, or more important. But we never forget that man is more noble than the god.